एक्टिविटी कर लीजिए। मैसेज डाल सकती है ना यहाँ, स्टार्ट क्लास स्टार्टेड लेने
आप यहाँ डाल सकते हैं।
लेवन में Today we'll see about the dissection of the orbit. The orbit is a pyramidal structure whose base is directed anteriorly and the apex is directed posteriorly. It has four walls: the roof, medial wall, floor and the lateral wall. The base is formed by the orbital margin. The apex is formed by the optic canal. The optic canal transmits the optic nerve and the ophthalmic artery. The roof is formed anteriorly by the orbital surface of the frontal bone and posteriorly by the orbital surface of lesser wing of sphenoid. The medial wall is the weakest of all and it is formed from before backwards by the frontal process of maxilla, the lacrimal bone, the orbital plate of ethmoid and the body of the sphenoid. The floor is formed anteromedially by the orbital surface of the maxilla, posteromedially by the orbital part of the palatine bone and anterolaterally by the orbital surface of the zygomatic bone. The lateral wall is formed by the orbital surface of the zygomatic bone anteriorly and the orbital surface of the greater wing of sphenoid posteriorly. The junction between the roof and the lateral wall presents the superior orbital fissure, whereas the junction between the lateral wall and the floor presents the inferior orbital fissure. So the following form the contents of the orbit, which include the eyeball, about which we have seen in detail in the past lecture class. Today we will be trying to identify the extraocular muscles, which include the superior rectus, inferior rectus, medial and lateral rectus, the superior oblique and the inferior oblique, and the levator palpable superioris. We will also try to identify the optic nerve, the 3rd, 4th, 6th cranial nerves within the orbit and the branches of the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve, which will include the frontal, nasociliary and the lacrimal nerves. We will also identify the ciliary ganglion, the ophthalmic artery. Apart from that, the orbit also contains the ophthalmic veins, the orbital fat and fascia and the lacrimal gland. So let's start with the dissection. Here we can see the calvarial cap has been removed and we are looking into the anterior cranial fossa, the middle cranial fossa and the posterior cranial fossa of the cranial cavity. We can identify the orbital plate of the frontal bone and the lesser wing of the sphenoid, which form the greater part of the roof of the orbit. So in the further step of our dissection, these bones which were forming the roof of the orbit has been removed and we can see the orbital periosteum, which is lining the contents of the orbit. So the orbital periosteum forms a funnel shaped structure which encloses the contents of the orbit and it is continuous posteriorly with the middle cranial fossa via the optic canal and the superior orbital fissure. Coming to the extraocular muscles, as we proceed further with the dissection, we have opened up the orbital periosteum and towards the midline, now we can identify a nerve. This nerve is the frontal nerve, about which we will see in detail shortly. Now just beneath the nerve, the muscle which we are able to see is the levator palpable superioris. Levator palpable superioris arises from the roof of the orbit just anterior to the optic canal. It extends forwards along the roof of the orbit over the superior rectus and as it reaches anteriorly, it becomes a broad membranous structure and inserts into the skin of the upper eyelid, the superior tarsal plate and the superior conjunctival fornix. Once we reflect the levator palpable superioris, we can see the nerve supplying the levator palpable superioris, which is the superior division of the oculomotor nerve. The main action of levator palpable superioris is, it helps to open the eye by raising the upper eyelid and the superior conjunctival fornix. So once we open the orbital periosteum, in the midline we have identified the frontal nerve and the levator palpable superioris. Now as we move towards the medial wall of the orbit, muscle which we identify is the superior oblique. The superior oblique also arises from the roof of the orbit, immediately anteromedial to the optic canal. After its origin, it extends forwards along the roof of the orbit, close to the medial wall of the orbit, and anteriorly it forms a tendon. This tendon of the superior oblique then enters the trochlea. As the tendon passes through the trochlea, it turns posterolaterally and passes between the superior rectus and the eyeball. Just lateral to the superior rectus, the tendon flattens out and is inserted into the sclera behind the equator. So the superior oblique is supplied by the trochlear nerve. So we can identify the trochlear nerve, the medial aspect of the orbit, medial aspect of the roof of the orbit, just medial to the frontal nerve entering the superior oblique muscle. The action of the superior oblique will be depression of the eyeball when the eyeball is adducted and intorsion of the eyes. So now we have identified the levator palpebral superioris and the superior oblique. Now once we reflect the levator palpebral superioris, the muscle which is seen beneath it is the superior rectus. The recti muscle all arise from the common tendinous ring. This common tendinous ring medially attaches to the superior orbital fissure. Laterally it attaches to the superior orbital fissure, and medially it attaches just above and medial to the optic canal. The superior rectus arises from the upper margin of the common tendinous ring. The common tendinous ring would be located somewhere here. So the superior rectus arises from the upper part of the common tendinous ring. After its origin, it extends forwards and laterally, making an angle of about 25 degrees with the primary axis. And it inserts into the sclera 6 mm behind the sclerocorneal junction. The superior rectus is also supplied by the superior division of the oculomotor nerve before it supplies the levator palpebral superioris. The main action of the superior rectus is elevation of the eye when the eye is adducted and the intorsion of the eye. After identifying the superior oblique, superior rectus, now we have reflected the superior rectus and we have entered into the deeper part of the orbit. Here we can identify the optic nerve emerging from the eyeball. Now as we move towards the medial wall of the orbit, just beneath the superior oblique muscle, we can identify one more muscle which is lying in the medial wall of the orbit, which is the medial rectus. Now in the further dissection, we have lifted up the optic nerve and we are getting a more clearer view of the medial wall of the orbit. Here we can identify the muscle which is very close to the roof is superior oblique, and the muscle which is deep to it lying on the medial wall is the medial rectus. The medial rectus arises from the medial margin of the common tendinous ring. It extends forwards along the medial wall of the orbit beneath the superior oblique muscle and is inserted into the medial part of the sclera 6 mm behind the sclerocorneal junction. It is supplied by the inferior division of the oculomotor nerve. Till now we saw the superior rectus and the levator palpebral were supplied by the superior division of the oculomotor nerve. Now the medial rectus is supplied by the inferior division of the oculomotor nerve. So here we can identify the twigs of the inferior division of the oculomotor nerve supplying the medial rectus. And the action of the medial rectus is the adduction of the eye. Now as we move towards the floor of the orbit, so we have completed the medial wall. In the medial wall we have identified the superior oblique and the medial rectus. Now as we move towards the floor of the orbit, the muscle which we identify is the inferior rectus. The inferior rectus arises from the inferior margin of the common tendinous ring extends forwards closely on the floor, close to the floor of the orbit, and is inserted into the sclera 6 millimeters behind the sclerocorneal junction. The inferior rectus is also supplied by the inferior division of the oculomotor nerve. Its main action is depression of the eye when the eye is abducted and extortion of the eye. So we have identified the superior rectus close to the roof, the medial rectus on the medial wall, the inferior rectus on the floor, and now as we move on to the lateral wall, the muscle which we identify lying on the lateral wall is the lateral rectus. The lateral rectus arises by two heads, one head from the lateral margin of the common tendinous ring, the other head from the adjoining part of the superior orbital fissure. As it arises, it after its origin, it extends forwards along the lateral wall of the orbit and inserts into the sclera 6 millimeter behind the sclerocorneal junction. We can see in the dissection picture the lateral rectus is being supplied by the nerve, and the nerve which supplies the lateral rectus is abducens nerve. Till now we have seen all the muscles being supplied by oculomotor nerve, the superior oblique being supplied by the trochlear nerve. Now the lateral rectus is being supplied by the abducens nerve. The main action of the lateral rectus is adduction of the eye. Now we are coming to the inferior oblique. In order to visualize the inferior oblique, we have lifted the orbicularis oculi from the lower eyelid and we have lifted the eyeball above to expose the floor of the orbit. And now we can see this muscle which is arising from the floor of the orbit, which is the inferior oblique. So the inferior oblique arises from the floor of the orbit just lateral to the nasolacrimal groove. After its origin, it extends posterolaterally, first between the floor of the orbit and eye, and then between the lateral rectus and the eye, and inserts into the sclera 6 mm behind the sclerocorneal junction. The inferior oblique is also supplied by the inferior division of the oculomotor nerve. Its main action is elevation of the eye when the eye is adducted and extortion of the eye. Now we have completed about the extraocular muscles. We have identified the four recti muscles. The superior rectus was identified on the roof. The medial rectus was identified on the medial wall deep to superior oblique. The inferior rectus was identified on the floor of the orbit. The lateral rectus was identified in the lateral wall of the orbit. The superior oblique was identified close to the roof on the medial wall, and the inferior oblique was identified close to the floor of the orbit. Now let us see about the nerves of the orbit. Now as we open the orbital periosteum, along the midline, we identified this nerve which was called the frontal nerve. The frontal nerve is the continuation of ophthalmic nerve. It extends forwards lying on the levator palpable superioris close to the roof of the orbit and ends by dividing into the supratrochlear and the supraorbital nerves. It enters the orbit through the lateral part of the superior orbital fissure. Now the supratrochlear nerve is the slender medial division which runs towards the pulley of the superior oblique and then exits the orbit and ends by supplying the forehead and the scalp. The supraorbital nerve is the larger lateral division. It exits the orbit by through the supraorbital foramen or notch and ends by supplying the forehead and the scalp. Now as we move towards the lateral wall of the orbit, we can identify one more slender nerve, which is the lacrimal nerve. The lacrimal nerve is the smallest subdivision of the ophthalmic nerve. You can see the ophthalmic nerve in the midline is giving the frontal nerve, then as we trace it laterally it is giving the lacrimal nerve. It enters the orbit through the lateral part of the superior orbital fissure along with the frontal and trochlear nerves. It mainly supplies the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers to the lacrimal gland, which it receives from the zygomatic nerve. The next nerve which we will be identifying is the nasociliary nerve. We can identify this nerve by identifying the optic nerve. First we identify the optic nerve, then we identify the nerve crossing the optic nerve from the lateral to the medial side, which is the nasociliary nerve. The nasociliary nerve is also a branch from ophthalmic nerve at the anterior end of the cavernous sinus. It enters the superior enters the orbit through the superior orbital fissure. Once it enters the orbit, it crosses the optic nerve from the lateral to the medial side, and at the medial wall of the orbit, it runs between the superior oblique and the medial rectus and ends by dividing into anterior ethmoidal nerve and the infratrochlear nerve. The other branches of the nasociliary nerve include the posterior ethmoidal nerve, the long ciliary nerves, which we are able to identify here. The long ciliary nerves are usually 2 in number. They mainly carry sensory fibers from the eyeball except the cornea, and also postganglionic sympathetic fibers to the dilator pupillae. The other important branch of the nasociliary nerve is the communicating branch to the ciliary ganglion. So the branches of the nasociliary nerve include anterior ethmoidal, posterior ethmoidal, infratrochlear, long ciliary, and branch to the ciliary ganglion. So coming to the ciliary ganglion. Ciliary ganglion is a peripheral parasympathetic ganglion of a large pinhead size, about 2 to 3 millimeter in diameter. It appears as a flat reddish gray mass connected with the nasociliary nerve, present between the optic nerve and the lateral rectus at the apex of the orbit. The ciliary ganglion receives three roots, which include the sympathetic root, the parasympathetic or motor root, and the sensory root. All these roots enter the ciliary ganglion through its posterior border. From the anterior border of the ganglion, we can see 8 to 10 nerves which are emerging out, and these would be the short ciliary nerves. So coming to the parasympathetic or the motor root, the motor root contains a preganglionic and postganglionic fibers. The preganglionic fibers arise from the Edinger Westphal nucleus, travel via the inferior division of oculomotor nerve and then nerve to inferior oblique to reach the ciliary ganglion, where they synapse. Fibers arising from the ciliary ganglion, which are the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers, travel via the short ciliary nerve to supply the sphincter pupillae and the ciliaris. So the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers mainly supply the ciliaris and the sphincter pupillae muscle and help in the pupillary light reflex. Coming to the sympathetic root, the sympathetic root is derived from the plexus around the internal carotid artery. It does not relay in the ciliary ganglion. The fibers just pass through the ciliary ganglion. The postganglionic sympathetic fibers supplying the dilator pupillae pass through the nasociliary and long ciliary nerve, whereas the postganglionic sympathetic fibers supplying the blood vessels pass through the short ciliary nerve. Now, till now we have seen the three branches of the ophthalmic nerve, which included the lacrimal nerve, nasociliary nerve, and the frontal nerve. And we have seen the ciliary ganglion, which is topographically connected with the nasociliary nerve. Now we are going to see about the cranial nerves present inside the orbit. So the first nerve we have identified is the optic nerve. The optic nerve emerges from the retina. It exits the orbit through the optic canal. The important relations of the optic nerve include three structures which cross it from lateral to medial side, close to the roof of the orbit. And these three structures include the superior ophthalmic vein, the nasociliary nerve, and the ophthalmic artery. The next cranial nerve is the trochlear nerve. So trochlear nerve is identified as a slender structure present along the medial side of the roof of the orbit, piercing the superior oblique. The next nerve is the abducens nerve, which we identified on the lateral wall of the orbit, lying on the lateral rectus and supplying it. Then we also identified the superior division of the oculomotor nerve, which was piercing the superior rectus, supplying it, and then piercing it, and then supplying the levator palpable superioris muscle. We also identified the inferior division of the oculomotor nerve, which was supplying the medial rectus, inferior rectus, and inferior oblique. Now coming to the ophthalmic artery. So the ophthalmic artery is a branch of internal carotid artery. It enters the orbit through the optic canal along with the optic nerve. Once it enters the orbit, initially it lies below the optic nerve. Then it extends lateral to the optic nerve. Then it winds above the optic nerve and crosses the optic nerve above it from the lateral to the medial side. Then it extends along the medial wall of the orbit and terminates by giving the dorsal nasal artery and the supratrochlear artery. One of the important branch of the ophthalmic artery is the central artery of the retina, which is the sole blood supply to the retina. Now we are coming to the facial sheath of the eyeball. The facial sheath of the eyeball can be identified in the picture by this blue line, which is going to extend from the optic nerve to the sclerocorneal junction. So this facial sheath, which encloses the eyeball, is called the fascia bulbi or the Tenon's capsule. Posteriorly, it is continuous with the dural sheath around the optic nerve. And anteriorly, it fuses with the ocular conjunctiva. Now there is a space between the sclera and the facial sheath of the eyeball. Now we can also see these muscles. As these muscles pierce the facial sheath of the eyeball, they also receive a prolongation of the facial sheath of the eyeball, and these prolongation of the facial sheath around the muscles fuse with the perimysium of the muscles. In this picture we can see the facial sheath of the eyeball is represented by the blue color, extending from the optic nerve to the sclerocorneal junction. We can also identify the facial sheath around the muscles. We can see an extension of the facial sheath around the medial rectus, extending on to the medial wall of the orbit to get attached to the lacrimal bone. So this extension is called the medial check ligament. Similarly, we can also see an extension from the facial sheath around the lateral rectus, going and attaching to the zygomatic bone on the lateral wall, and this extension is called the lateral check ligament. The medial and the lateral check ligament limit the movement of the medial rectus and the lateral rectus, and hence they were termed as medial and lateral check ligaments. Now we will see what does the word suspensory ligament of the eyeball means. Now in this picture we can see, then we can identify the medial rectus, the lateral rectus, the inferior rectus and inferior oblique, each of them being surrounded by the facial sheath around it. The facial sheath on the along the inferior wall of the inferior rectus thickens and fuses with the facial sheath of the inferior oblique, and this facial sheath extends medially to the facial sheath around the medial rectus and is attached to the lacrimal bone. It also extends laterally to the facial sheath around the lateral rectus and gets attached to the zygomatic bone. So this sling shaped structure, which acts as a hammock and supports the eyeball from below, is called the suspensory ligament of the eyeball. Coming to the term called orbital septum. So what is orbital septum? Orbital septum is a thin membranous sheet which is attached to the orbital rim. When we trace it posteriorly, it is continuous with the orbital periosteum. When we trace it anteriorly, it is continuous with the tarsal plates of the upper and the lower eyelid. Now this orbital septum is an important clinical landmark to differentiate between the different types of cellulitis. So So the in case the facial sheath of the eyeball is known as the Tenon scapula or fascia bulbi. It presents the medial and lateral cheek ligaments. It also presents the suspensory ligament of the eyeball, and then the one more connective tissue which we identify here is the orbital septum, which is attached to the orbital margins. So that completes the orbital dissection. And dissection of the anterior triangle will be at 2 o'clock.